The evolutionary theories, the first one is the acquired characteristics which was given by Lamarck. It is Jean-Baptiste de Lamarck, who lived from 1744 to 1829. Traits acquired in organisms for the lifetime. Another, what he said is the acquired characteristics are passed down to the offsprings. So whatever the characteristics that the parents have, that will be passed to the next generations only. So what is the basic idea of Lamarckism? So Lamarck has postulated not doing any kind of experimentations, and he said that the use of organs, whatever the organisms are there, so the use of the organs are giving the structures which are better in the next generation. So the use or the disuse of the organs, there the structures have disappeared. So ultimately inheritance of a new acquired characters have come into existence, and thus origin of new species have been evolved. So, but what Charles Darwin has given the theory of natural selection, each species so shows a variation, shut it shortly, but there is a competition within each species within the for the food, living space, water, mates, etc. So in that particular, so intraspecific, we say interspecific, in between the species only there will be the competition. So here what they will tell, here the better adapted members of the species are more likely to survive. So that is why this theory is called as the survival of the fittest. Which species is able to survive in that particular environment, that particular species will be there, and the other organisms which are not able to survive in the new environment, they have to perish away. So survival of the fittest was the best adapted theory among all the scientists over the in the world. So if you see into the next slide, so what is happening is the Charles Darwin postulated the theory which we call it as Darwinism. And what is the summary of the Darwin's theory is that individual organisms in the nature differ from one another. Some of these variations are inherited. So organisms in nature produce more offsprings that can survive, and many of those that do not survive. So what is happening? They do not reproduce. So they do not reproduce because more organisms are produced than can survive. Members of the each species must compete for the resources naturally. When there is more population, what is happening? So if for example one resource has to be shared by some 100 people, if 200 organisms, living organisms are coming for the competition, so what will happen? They have to compete for the resources because each organism is very unique. Each has different advantages and disadvantages in the struggle for existence. So the natural selection, what it says is individuals better adapted to the environment are able to survive and reproduce. Who are able to survive? Only those who have adapted to that particular environment only. Now there is a variation in a population according to the Darwin's theory, and those that are better suited to the environment survive over others to reproduce. These characteristics are passed down to the next generation. So from one generation to another generation, the characters have been transferred basing on this particular trait. Now coming to the third theory of evolution is the mutation theory, which is very, very important. Can you see these are all the chromosomes? The chromosomes, as you know, they are the genetic materials for the for the characters to be formed in the next generations. Or you can say that the chromosomes are the vehicles for the different kinds of traits to pass from one generation to the another generation. In 1901, Hugo de Veres is a scientist who has proposed this mutation theory. What according to that, he says that the mutations are caused due to variations. If there are any variations only, the mutations will occur. Mutations are not any continuous process. He believed that mutations will change the genetic material. Yes. So what is happening? A new character has been evolved in this process of mutation. So when a new character is evolved, definitely new species will come into existence. So De Vries based this theory on his reproduction experiments in the evening primrose. So whatever was that was postulated by Darwin, a very great scientist Hugo De Vries said that he has conducted the experiments in this particular evening primrose and have come to the conclusion that the complete inheritance are only due to the variations. So whatever is happening here, the prominent features of the mutation theory are mutations are always they are the discontinuous variations and they are the raw materials for the evolution. So mutations are the raw materials for the evolutions and mutations appear all of a sudden. So all the mutations will appear all of a sudden. They become operational immediately. So all of a sudden they will appear and also they become operational. Whenever they will come suddenly, immediately they start operating also in that particular organism. And unlike Darwin's continuous variations or fluctuations, mutations do not revolve around the mean or the normal character of the species. So that in that particular species, these mutations will not even revolve. The same type of mutations can appear in a number of individuals of that particular species. So same number of mutations can also appear here in this, according to this mutation theory, and all mutations are inheritable. So there is no guarantee that if mutation occurs in one generation, it has to occur in the next generation. This may or may not occur in the next generation. Now that is about the theory about the theories of evolution. Now let us see the modern theories of evolution. The modern theory of evolution includes both Darwin's ideas of variation and natural selection and the current knowledge of the sources of variation. Now what are the sources of variation? If you see the sources of variation, segregation and the recombination of alleles are during the sexual reproduction are playing a very important role during the process of variations. Mutations are random changes. They are the random changes in the genes or DNA of the sex cells that may result in the new genes combining the variations. So the different kinds of genes are also being observed in this particular species. Now then here if you look about the neo-Darwinism, an explanation of the origin of species was explained by neo-Darwinism. Ernst Mayr. He is from 1904 to 2005, and the systemics of, and the origin of species, he has given the population genetics. Population genetics is nothing but the genetics of the large populations are stable because of the new characters. So the large populations, wherever you see the populations which are very large, they have a very new character that they have adapted to adjust to the environment. And that new character traits are muted by the large gene pool and little chance of genetic differentiation into the new species. So variations are seen only in the new species, and that too they may or may not come. So in small isolated populations, the genetic anomalies can become more prominent and quicker. So what he want to say is that, so large populations are having lots of characters in it, and genetic isolation of subpopulation that is separated from the main population by migration, geographic barriers, or lack of mobility. So what is this migration? Due to migration also there will be, why the animals will migrate? The animals migrate from one place to another in search of food or shelter or basic requirement, not only the basic requirements but also for reproduction. The as you know, the salmon fishes, they migrate for reproduction and spawning from fresh water to the sea water and from sea water to the fresh water. In the same way, birds also, they will come from Siberian cranes, they will come from very long distances to the Kolleru lakes of Andhra Pradesh for not only for reproduction but also for adjusting themselves for climatic conditions also. So this by this word migration, what is happening here? The reproductive traits are giving rise to the origin of new species. So the lack of mobility and also the genetic divergence, which is causing the allopatric speciation. So the evolutionary mechanisms which was given by all the these theories, Lamarckism, the characteristic main proponents is Lamarck. Characteristics is use causes development of new characteristics that come under inheritability. Darwinism, as you know, only the nature will select, and he has also said that not only natural selection but also survival of the fittest are inheritance by the gemmules. Now mutations are emphasized, natural selection not as important, but mutation changes are seen in the mutational theory. But modern synthetic theory of evolution, which we call it as neo-Darwinism, that is modern synthetic theory of evolution, which is very very important. Here so many proponents are there: Dobansky, Fisher, Haldane, Huxley. So right, all these scientists, they have independently discovered the same conclusion, is that the changes in the populations are very very important, but the small mutations which are acted upon the natural selection and relation to the traditional classification. So what they have given, so apart from this Darwinism, so they it is called as neo-Darwinism. And the diversification, 1968 to present, diversification is the multiplicity of the conflicting ideas in the process of organic evolution. Here the dissatisfaction with the modern synthetic theory of evolution, because their search for the cause is a big complexity. So they need to know more about the process of evolution. So what is happening in this mechanisms? Not only this, they have seen another law which is called as the Hardy-Weinberg's equilibrium. So two scientists by name Hardy and Weinberg, they have independently has done the research on this particular. This is about the populations, where here Hardy-Weinberg law always stands one. Here p plus q whole square is equal to 1. This always stands good. So what does this says? P square plus 2pq plus q square is equal to 1. That means here p is the frequency of recessive allele. So that is the trait for p. So it is a recessive allele for A, and Q is the frequency of the dominant allele A, that is the capital A. So what is happening? Alleles and the genotypes are frequencies, and they are sum up to number 1 in the populations. If you see different kinds of questions and also examples, you always the genotypic and the genotypic and also the allelic frequencies are stable and they are predictable, and always the frequency for alleles AA will be A square and capital A's will be Q square, and capital A and small a it is 2pq, and it is equal to 1. So whatever the traits are the in a group of populations or number of populations, if you take any kind of questions or examples in this particular Hardy-Weinberg law, the ratios or the frequencies or the genotype frequencies, their sum is always equal to 1. So next, the Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, what does it actually it want to give a solution for this process of evolution, is that it is defined as the situation in which no evolution is occurring. Evolution is absolutely zero and it is not occurring. It is a genetic equilibrium. So all the genes are maintained equally. That is why it is equal to 1. So it holds good. So the genetic equilibrium is always is always a constant. It was the solution of the 19th century misconception of the notion that the dominance or recessiveness of an allele only could cause the evolutionary change. So here what they wanted to say is that the dominance of any particular gene in one generation or recessiveness of any particular gene in the next generation, they could only lead to the formation of any evolutionary change. So if you take a cross, if you go to the genetics, a cross between a red rose, if you take a red rose and a white rose, what is happening? In the next generation, definitely a red or a white has to come. But what is happening? A new color called as pink rose is evolving in the F1, that is first filial generation. So from where this character pink is coming when it is not present in both the parents? So this was a recessive gene which was present in one of the parents and it is expressed in the first generation. Such kind of dominances are called as incomplete dominance. This is called as incomplete dominance, and such things are providing the basic evidences or the proofs for the evolution of the life. Okay, and what the Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium refers to a particular locus. One locus may be undergoing rapid allele frequency. What is this locus? If you look into the structure of the chromosome, see, this is the chromosome. As you all know, this is the centromere. These are the chromatids. So, the chromatids, this is the centromere. These are the chromatids. On the chromatids are present the genes. So, genes are present like this on the chromatids. So, for example, if this is gene X and this is gene A, this is gene B, this is gene D, just assume, and this is gene Y. So, this particular gene which is present, which I am calling as X, this gene residence is here only. I mean to say, residence is nothing but the locus. So one particular gene which is residing in that particular area or that site is called as the locus. So this particular locus is also influencing some characters in the next generation. For example, this particular X is a gene which is giving color, white color, to the offsprings or children in the next generation. This particular locus of Y gene is responsible for intelligence, and this gene is responsible for the some height. So like that, all these locuses are also paying. That's what here in the Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium says, that one locus may be undergoing a rapid allele frequency change while the others locus are in the same equilibrium. That means one locus may or may not give rise to the formation of a new characters. So this is about what the Hardy-Weinberg law says. Next one, Amma. Now, what are the evolutionary forces? So, the evolutionary forces are nothing but the natural selection and the fitness. So, up till now, even natural selection was completely adapted and accepted by all the scientists throughout the world, that only survival of the fittest will only have that particular right to pass their characters from one generation to another. In other words, if mutations, gene flow and non-random mating, genetic drifts or natural selections are occurring, then evolutionary forces are acting on that particular population. So what are evolutionary forces? They are nothing but the mutations, gene flow and also random mating. That means a mate between a species of one group and also a species of the other group. That means, so such mates also gives rise to new species. For example, a cross between a donkey and a horse is giving rise to a mule. So all these things are the different evolutionary forces which are giving rise to a new species. So the more again in this evolutionary forces, you can see the genetic change in the population. What is genetic change? It is nothing but the gene flow, the movement of alleles into or out of the population. So these alleles are moving inside or outside of the population. We call it as gene flow. Occurs only in the new individuals. So that too where only in the process of migration. Immigration or exmigration will happen, and the alleles will be seen moving from one population to the another population, and such phenomenon we call it as a gene flow. Then what is this non-random mating? Here when individuals prefer to mate with others that live nearly or are of their own phenotype. So they may have this selection choice of the same phenotype or based on certain traits. So when the choice method was given, then definitely the random and non-random mating methods are giving an evolutionary force for the new populations to occur. And not only that, the genetic drift, as I told you, the allele frequency in this particular population will always be, the allele frequency will be seen in this particular phenomenon. And also the natural selections, which are causes of the deviations from the Hardy-Weinberg's law, by directly changing the allele frequencies, since some alleles are being selected and that will be spread in the population. So only that selected species will be taken into consideration and the others will be withered away due to all these reasons. Now let us talk about speciation. What is a speciation? The formation of new species is called as speciation, and it occurs over time. So suddenly over a night new species will not evolve on the earth, is it not? So this is a slow and continuous process to occur. So such process are also the driving forces for the evolution. So the speciation is the formation of new species by evolution from the pre-existing species. The speciation rarely occurs overnight, it usually occurs in stages over generations. So it will not occur overnight, but it takes some time from one generation to another generation. Speciation has occurred when the net effects of evolutionary forces results in the population that has very, very unique features of reproductive isolation. What is reproductive isolation? When there is a barriers, when there is geographical barriers, when they are isolated, hence their inside genes or alleles will be the same. But what is happening, they will give rise to the new species when it is being separated by geographical boundaries.